Welcome back to Music Lab's Other Stuff. I'm your host, Gary. My name shall remain anonymous, but I've told you every week since up here, so I guess it's not. In studio now, we have a very special guest, Santa Claus. No, sorry. I get those names mixed up. Miss Krystin Pellerin. Hello, Krystin.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good.
Good. It's like we started talking because we haven't... interviews are weird because you... Before you talk, obviously, like we just did, and then when the interview turns on, it's like, oh, we haven't spoke yet the whole time. You're just sitting here waiting for me to press play. Well, welcome.
This is great to be here.
Well, no, it's not.
Sure it is.
I actually didn't realize that strategically, Doyle, the new episode of Doyle comes on tonight.
It does. It does.
You knew that. I did not know that. I was like, oh, sly. But that's good. That plays well. How many episodes are left?
I think there are three left. I'm not sure which one. I'm not sure which number.
And is there talks about a season 5?
Yeah, we're waiting to hear. We should hear any day.
Well.
Fingers crossed.
That's, yeah. That's exciting. Well... You do the Salt Pepper thing, right? So would you, if Doyle didn't continue, would you take on that full time?
I mean, the way that it goes, like the life of an actor, you just sort of wait to see what happens. So I would love to go. I love working there and I would love to go back. So, but I'm open. I'm open to whatever comes to the table.
So if I put off a play in my basement for like 5 people, would you be the lead? Like would that, it's work, right? It's work. We'd pay you in cookies and
cookies.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not. I'd have to think about it.
Okay. Well, they're good cookies. They're jam jams. So I mean, you can't really beat a jam jam.
Actually, I only get paid in jam jams. It's
and Doyle.
Oh yeah,
I thought so. Yep. Yeah.
Every contract, I'm only paid in jam jams.
You demand it. Yeah.
I demand. Yeah.
We'll give you 10,000. No, I want jam jams.
Jam jams. 10,000. Jam jams.
Jam jams, yes. In a big truck labeled Krystin's Jam Jams. That'd be a waste of time. That wouldn't work for Jam Jam. Jam jams are weird. When they get hard, they're useless. They're
not the same. They're not as good.
No. Well, listen, if you took a downward spiral just now, talking about Jam Jams. All right.
Hey, that's not so downward.
Okay. We spoke earlier about your accent. On the show, and I mentioned how that was, I was kind of surprised because I knew you were from here, and I thought, oh, that's her natural accent, and then, boom, no accent, so I'm like, what? So I was like, was that, I guess, daunting for you to kind of get that, like, where you're from here, to get that right accent, so people go, man, what is this?
It sort of felt like the right thing to do for the character, and I had been living away for a long time and gone to school in Montreal and everything, so then I really felt like I was coming home after a long time, but it felt right for the character, and it was sort of a tricky thing to do to get back into that, and because it's not my voice, it's not me, it's Leslie, so it took some time to sort of find out how to get comfortable. And
so were you coached for that accent, or was that something you
it just sort of came up naturally, sort of just playing around. Yeah.
I don't think your character has ever said the word la, has she? And she, if she has not, I would like that next episode. Hey Jake, la. just not even in context, just la.
Doesn't need a context.
Yeah, la. That's it.
It stands alone.
The cheese stands alone. Nope. Yeah, so I find that... it's good. It's good accent. I noticed that Alan, that's his voice.
Yeah.
He don't really do one, because I've watched interviews. I'm like, oh, that's actually his... I was actually watching interviews with you and him, and... I laughed because like I'm from here too, but yeah. I always find it funny when like just certain words the Newfoundlanders say that we say are just they sound funny, like instead of throat, that to me is hilarious. Like, oh yeah, I got hit in the throat. What's the throat? What's the? In an interview, he was like, yeah, he was talking about something. He was like, yeah, you know, it's not like we're actually shoving it down your throat. I'm like, what? Throat? That's hilarious.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I mean, what do you think of the Newfoundland accent? Because you got, like, you know, the town, which is kind of mine, which is not really there, prominent. But then you have the Bay accent, which is just, what? I don't know what he's saying.
I think it's the hardest. I think for someone who's not from here, it's a lot. Well, it's like Ireland in that, like, you drive half hour, it's different, or a different part of town is different. But I think being not from here and having to learn this accent, I think I know maybe one person who does it, who can do it, who's his name is Albert Schultz. He's actually he's the artistic director of Soul Pepper, and he can do a real Newfoundland accent, and he's from Port Hope, Ontario, and he knows he can do it for sure. But for somebody having to learn it, I just think it would be so hard.
Well, it's hard because when people try to do it, it usually just comes across as either Irish or potatoes, jams.
But it's not Irish.
I know, but just for people, because people don't know what to go to, because it's a different, or people just do it horribly wrong, and it sounds atrocious.
It doesn't. It does.
I'm mother love, man. That's not. We don't talk like that. No one speaks of that.
I know. I know. I know.
So I can't even really say anything about the Bay because they could listen to this. You're awesome, Bayman. La. Yeah. Okay. So, have a couple of questions. Have a couple of Doyle questions,
mm-hmm.
and a couple of favorite questions.
Okay.
Which are not my favorites, but like, what's your favorite blah, 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 blah. What is your favorite blah, blah, blah? The third one, probably? The tone is...
Yeah. I'd go with that one. That's my favorite.
Good. Okay. Do you notice a difference personally from theater acting and television acting?
Definitely.
Like, do you prepare differently?
Definitely. Well, you... I mean, the situation, the way that it's been working since the show started and being able to go back and forth is ideal as an actor, for me anyway, because in a play, you prepare to go through the whole story in a night, and in television, you break it up, and it's like two different toolboxes. But I think that acting is acting, and we always just try to be as truthful and convincing as possible and true to the story, but it's great to be able to flex different muscles. And
so what's different about it?
I think in a play we get to rehearse, and luckily at Soul Pepper we have the luxury of a substantial amount of rehearsal time, so you get to get really deep into the story and get to make it repeatable. So we have to make the story repeatable every night, and it just feels it feels more athletic, because mm-hmm. we're in a theater. We kind of have to project, and the emotion and everything has to sort of read to the back of the room, and it has to fill the space in a different way. And then in television, it requires a different kind of stamina, where you have a few takes to sort of get to the heart of the moment, and it's much more intimate. You kind of have it's really a nice feeling, actually, to be able to be sitting across from each other like me and you are right now, and to have a camera sort of capturing it all. But we get to, you know, really connect that way. It sort of feels just for us in the room, and it's I like both.
I feel like I should light a candle after that. what would you rather? Would you rather do theater compared to television, or television compared to theater?
I feel like I would like to have both. I can't imagine going without doing a play for too long, because even now, like, I need it. I feel like I just need it. I need to sort of be on stage and doing that, and I love going back to set, but I definitely need to be on stage and to keep that a part of my life.
Well, yeah, a lot of artists, I guess, just in general, like musicians and everything, who perform on stage, like the, like me, like I like the stage. It's one of those things that, you know, you there's really no substitution.
It's immediate, right? Yeah. It's immediate. It's totally alive and charged. And you get, I mean, it's alive and charged in a different way on set. But when you have that relationship with the audience, I don't know how. Yeah, you can't. I love it.
So, do you find it more? Are you more nervous doing a play where it's live? At least, you know, like on television, if you fool up, you can do another take. Like, are you nervous in that aspect? More so over television, I mean.
It's a different kind of nerves. Like I find I like the rush of performing live, and I like the adrenaline that comes with that. And I do get nervous, but that's a good thing, and it keeps you sharp. And on set, there's a lot of downtime. So, and then you're asked to sort of deliver at a moment's notice. And that leads to a different kind of nervous energy, but that too, it keeps you sharp. So if I wasn't nervous, I would feel uneasy about that. So it's good to be nervous, is a good thing. Keeps you on your toes.
That leads to my next question. If you have ever, you know, you've been acting for a long while, so you probably have. What's the biggest mess up you've had on stage? If any, you may not, maybe not. Maybe you're
the biggest mess up.
Yeah, like maybe you tripped coming in, or you just forgot a line and froze, or you punched someone in the face in the audience. I don't know why you did that, but
yeah, oh yeah, all the time. I'm just trying to think. Any screw up feels huge, no matter how it looks like on the outside. It feels huge if you miss a line or if you sort of trip.
One that not only you would know about
like
as an
would
actor.
Gasp kind of word, like that would make.
Yeah, like a blatant like audience, like whoa, well, I don't think that's supposed to happen. Like the Christian Bale blow up. Not like that, but not you know, but like
thrown a fit.
No, like an obvious one that people like. Whoa, that's.
I tripped down the stairs once, a big flight of stairs. I can't remember a big sort of, I have selective memory. Maybe I'm just like choosing.
You block them
out. I block it out. Maybe
didn't happen
traumatized.
To me.
Never happened to me.
That was
maybe
Hako.
There was some huge.
Hako took your shirt off and fell down the stairs.
Some huge thing. I can't think of like a big sort of sensational one.
So how did you recover from the fall down the stairs? You just get up and go, it didn't happen. It was part of it. It's part of the character.
Yeah, you just sort of keep going. I had hurt my ankle and I had to go on anyway because they don't have we didn't have a
understudy.
So I had to sort of keep going, but I had really hurt my ankle badly, and I had to run down the stairs in heels and then tripped. But that's nothing to write home about. I wish I had something amazing to say, like I got sick or something, but I don't. Oh, man.
What about, have you ever witnessed one?
I know somebody who had to go on, who'd lost their voice completely, and had to go on anyway because there wasn't an understudy, and they had to put like a voice box or something so that he could be projected, like a mic that was really close to his throat. And you know those people who have smokers who had cancer.
Yeah, yeah.
So he sort of sounded like that through the entire play. There was a girl who had. I was called in the night before. The girl had an inner ear infection, and she couldn't like pick herself off the floor because the room was just spinning, and she could not come in and do it. And they spent. It was she was the lead in the show, and I got the call at like 10 o'clock at night, and then I tried to memorize the entire part all the way like through the whole night, and then got a call in the morning that she was going to be fine. That was scary. That's not like an awesome story.
I'm kind of disappointed.
I know.
I was expecting like, this big hole in the stage and flames and devoured the cast.
No, it's nothing like that. Oh, well.
Well, that's the interview, guys.
and good night.
Ah, see you later. So if you weren't acting, what do you think you'd be doing?
I'd be singing. I'd have music in my life for sure.
Okay, let's strip away the arts.
All together?
Yeah, let's take away the arts. If there was no arts existent.
No arts at all?
You didn't have any opportunity to do any kind of art.
I would be working bilingually somehow, because I'm really keen about working in both languages.
So like Tim Hortons?
Tim Hortons. How did you... You read my mind. I know. How did you know?
That's every Canadian's dream, really.
That's... yeah.
Everyone wants to say, do you want a double cup of that? That's a dream. That's a dream. Just my first words when I came out of the womb.
But I would like to work... I think I'd probably... I'd like to work traveling somehow, like working internationally. And
so like business?
Not necessarily business. It's hard to take the arts out of it entirely. Oh, it is, yeah. I mean, I can't really say... I can't really give you an answer. I can say that I could... I would like to... If I wasn't performing, I would like to work at a teaching maybe, or helping people find their own creative voice. I'd like to work in French and English, and I'd like to travel.
So you're completely bilingual?
Yes.
Well, show off. There's something that the people that know how to do that, and I know a few of them how to do that. Like my girlfriend's French, but she speaks English also.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm like, how do you even learn a language? I don't understand. Like, I don't know. Maybe I'm stupid. I don't understand how you could learn a language. That's stupid. That's stupid if you're stupid.
No.
How you learn a language so well. You know what I mean? That you can talk.
Well, we were put, like, me and my sisters were in immersion from kindergarten. So then we did it all through school. And then I just kind of like it as kind of a hobby. I'm curious about it. I like languages. And so I sort of continue it in my spare time. And it's just like out of pure curiosity. And I keep it up that way. But if you don't use it, then it,
well, I
you
did it
lose
from,
it.
From grade 4 to 9, and that was a while ago, 4 to 9, and then I did it last semester, and I'm useless in French now. Like, I know verbs, I can't say a sentence, I can tell you a bunch of adjectives, you can put it together, but tableau. That's it.
I think you'd be surprised if you were put in an immersion situation. I think that you would be surprised as to how much you could speak and understand.
I would draw pictures of what I wanted.
You'd have like little cue cards.
Yeah. Like, I went to Saint Pierre.
I've never been.
It's actually really nice.
Yeah.
It's really small, and you walk around the whole area. But went my last year, junior high, grade 9. And I did French for 5 years leading up to that, and I didn't know, like, if I want to know where a bakery was, I just went to patisserie. Like, that's it. I don't know how to put any words in front of that. Like, where is, or where, who is? I don't, just the word. You get the word, and you got to put it together. What does he want? To buy one? No, I just want a baguette.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's all you need.
That's all you need, really.
That's all you need, but if you need to get by.
Who needs a telephone when you're in trouble? What's your favorite, it's probably be hard since it's 4 seasons, but what's your favorite episode, if you had to pick one, of Doyle?
Favorite episode, that is hard, because there have been a lot of really great moments, and it feels like, to me, it feels like a big movie, so. My favorite episode. That's a trick question. I really liked...
Like, this season was really different for your character.
I loved going undercover. I loved going undercover. I loved that whole process of getting ready for that and doing all the research and everything that went with it. I love the storyline between, like, I love the whole storyline between Jake and Leslie, and I love getting to play that with Alan, like, from the very beginning of season one right up till now. I just love playing that, that whole story, so.
Ever wonder if Alan puts the kissing things in on purpose? We don't really need for Jake and Leslie to kiss her, but I'm gonna put it in.
I don't ask questions.
Yeah, I was gonna put it in. Well, the scene is.
You got it. We're just doing what's written.
Alan's like, yeah, okay. So this part of the scene, I'm gonna go walk to my GTO, and I'm gonna open the door. But Jake and Leslie are gonna kiss, I think, just for no reason. We're just gonna get in, and she's not gonna be there. We're gonna Photoshop her face, and then I'll take off my shirt and drive away. I'll probably never get him in now if he hears this. I asked you about season five. It must be hard for, because I know like Alan does writing and stuff, but it must be hard just to keep it going. Because if that was me, I wouldn't be able to write past like the third episode. Does it keep it going for like 4 or 5 years?
I think it's one of the challenges. I mean, I have such admiration for writers, and I'm totally in awe of them and how they manage to do it. Because I think to keep a story going over the course of 4 seasons and hopefully into 5 seasons, and keeping all the storylines connected, and keeping an audience engaged, I think is just amazing. So. I don't know how they do it, but they do an excellent job.
So I guess you guys must have seen like the whole province by now.
Sorry?
You guys must have seen the whole province by now. You do so many on location scenes, like the Brius one, and like you must have been around the whole.
Well, we're in St. John's. The only time we went outside St. John's was for the Brius one. I think they did the episode in St. Pierre. They did. There was a second unit that went to. St. Pierre to get exterior shots, but everything was shot in St. John's. But it was nice to go. It was nice to go outside the city.
Brius, yeah.
Yeah, it was really pretty.
I know, like the guy that finds the shots, hats off to him, because like every shot has a fantastic scenery, something.
I know it's gorgeous. It just showcases the whole province.
But then people come here and see like the crappy press. Go, man, what? This was not in the show. Like that one alley downtown where it's just always dark and sketchy. That's never on the show. That should be there.
They shouldn't be there. What are they doing in that alleyway?
Why does Shake have his shirt off again? In an alleyway where it's dark. So what was high school like for you? Like was acting a big thing in high school for you too?
Yeah, I went to PWC to... because of the theater program and because Tolson Barrington was teaching there, and I wanted to do acting. So, when I went to high school, I was doing plays all the time, and I was in choir and chamber choir and jazz band and jazz combo. And
so were you a cool kid?
You were like,
that Krystin Pellerin. She's a cool
kid. I don't think I was cool, no.
Theater gets a bad rap. No, no.
Like, cool-wise, you mean?
Yeah. Theater gets a bad... It's always like the... Oh, he plays hockey. He's awesome! Oh, my God!
Theater... Yeah, I was in the theater room and in the music room. So, I liked it.
Oh, yeah. When you're in it, you'll love it, but... I don't know.
I don't know about the cool factor, but I felt good.
I was cool. I was smoking in the boys' room, and I wasn't even a boy. No, it's weird. It's weird. It's, because I did theater, but you know, it's different. Theater is different when you're. It's just it has its, I guess, own big click.
Yeah,
like
it
theater
does.
Is theater kind of thing
in high school.
Yeah,
especially like all those little groups and everything.
But then you got people in the theater that's like, whoa, that's a different person right there.
Yeah,
but that's what the stage brings out, I guess. Did you have a lot of support, like from your family, to go into the arts?
I've been extremely lucky because my parents have always been 100% behind, you know, my decision. So I'm really, really lucky that way. I'm amazed at people who continue to do it in spite of that, and who like don't have a supportive family, who want them to go and do other things, and they go off and do their own thing anyway. I think that takes a lot of courage and a lot of guts. And so, but my parents have always been really supportive.
Yes. Well, I think the problem is just people look at it as just not realistic, where the chances are so low to actually succeed with it. That's why I think parents are like, no, you got a business or something.
Yeah, it's just a looking gambling. Out for their best interest. Yeah. Yeah.
But it's great they actually had support to do. I mean, even if they didn't and you still became big. Ah, see? Told you. Here's a house. You know? Like, what do you... I guess your parents sound like, you know, wow. That's my daughter.
They're really supportive, but they would... I mean, they've always said that they would be supportive no matter whatever me or my sisters decided to do, they would support us. And as long as we were happy and healthy, they would be happy.
So do you get noticed a lot around town? Like just now when you're upstairs, did anyone? Well, no, I guess it's like five people up there, so you can't really use it in this example. But in general,
it's really really nice to be in St. John's because everybody sort of comes up and has, you know, it's just so kind. And yeah, we definitely we feel the love around town.
Have you had a weird experience with a fan like that? You had to in 4 years. You've had someone just be odd and ask for a weird thing.
I have
or something.
One good story, sort of.
Okay, now you gotta make up for your theater stories. Here it is.
I know.
Pressure's on.
Oh god, I'm sweating bullets.
I know.
So, and I've said this story before because it's my one story. I was in the Dominion. And
I was in Dominion
and I was picking out mustard. And I was looking at the mustard.
Let's just stop you right here. Always a great intro to a great story is Dominion and mustard. Go ahead.
And I sort of felt somebody real close to me looking over my shoulder. And I didn't look. And some guy leaned in and said, "That one's good." And I said, "Oh, thanks. Okay, maybe I'll get honey Dijon or whatever." And then he comes right into my face and he goes, "Are you? You knows who you are." So that was it. That was the one that was funny.
Then he just walked away? Is that how that went down?
Pretty much. He just walked away.
So he leaned in to your face, said that, and just like, Batman smoke grenade out of there?
Yeah.
Is that how that went down? You didn't answer him or?
I just smiled. I didn't say anything really. But that was the fun. But I don't have any, like, again, I don't really have any great.
Was that
stories.
Recent?
No, that was a while ago. Oh, I think that was like 2 years ago. Yeah. There you go.
That's.
I wish I had some diamonds for you.
Yeah. Next time. Was he like an older guy?
He was an older guy.
Are you?
No, not that. Not that. Not quite that old.
Hey, you stopped my joke dead cold. Jeez.
Sorry.
Never mind. It's done now. So what was your reaction? Like when he walked away, you were just like, "Whoa, what's?"
I thought it was funny.
You just laughed. You weren't scared. That'd be weird.
I wasn't scared. I was in Dominion. I wasn't scared.
I seen Alan Doyle in Dominion once.
Alan Doyle's so awesome.
Yeah, he's in Dominion. Walking around with shorts on.
Oh, yeah? Must have been summertime.
My story's worse than yours. Jeez, mine. That was a cul-de-sac. They never went anywhere. Seen him. That was it. Picking our produce. Okay, see, I got a bunch of questions like this now, so you can't disappoint. All right, pressure's on.
Okay,
pressure's
okay,
on.
Okay, okay,
what's
okay.
What's your most embarrassing moment? Does have to be acting-wise, just in general.
My most embarrassing moment? I don't know if I want to say that on the radio. My most embarrassing moment... My most embarrassing moment might be walking in the Eaton Center and having my dress kind of be up, like tucked into my, like, be totally exposed walking in the Eaton Center and having nobody tell me that I was flashing everybody. And well, I think I must have been walking like that for a good 7 minutes in the Eaton Center, totally like flashing the world.
Wait, now, tucked into your underpants?
Yeah.
Okay, well, you weren't totally flashing, I guess.
I guess not.
Semi.
Well, maybe I'm being a little... Yeah, no, it was pretty embarrassing. That was pretty embarrassing. That was pretty embarrassing. Again, it's not. I don't have anything like...
How'd you find out? Did you just... Oh,
it's... It felt a little airy.
Oh. It's a bit windy.
I found out on my own.
It's a bit windy in here
today.
I found
out on my own, and I thought, oh my God, where are all the good people in the world who would come up and tell you, you gotta pull your dress
down? Well, you must have walked into like the guys section of the mall. No dude's gonna be like, hey, missus!
Your dress
is drafty over there.
I was walking for so long like that. Nobody said anything. Oh my God.
Is that recent? No recent story.
That was in the summer. Or in the spring. Yeah.
Okay.
Half
recent.
Well,
that makes sense. Can't be in winter.
It could be in the winter.
That was no embarrassing stage. Call a character wrong. Nah, that's not embarrassing. That's
know. I wish I had something for you. I wish. And I can't even make anything up. I'm terrible at that.
I don't know how to come back from your story there.
Oh, you don't know how to.
Okay, switch topics. What's your favorite food?
My favorite food.
Fish and chips.
I like dark chocolate. I like dark chocolate. A lot. It's
but good. Meal-wise?
Meal-wise?
Well, you probably eat that for supper.
I like salmon. I like, what do I like? Well, yeah, I like sushi.
Any cliche? Newfoundland, fish and chips, jigs dinner? Hard bread from Purity?
I like a good jigs dinner.
Fish
I like
and brews.
Christmas dinner. I like. I know. I don't think I've ever had fish and brews.
You never had fish and brews?
No, and I don't think. I'd
from
like
Mount
it.
Pearl, so I guess.
Hey, we don't have fish and brews out there.
No.
I've never had it, but I don't know if I'd like it. It might be a bit too salty.
No, fish and brews is not that salty. Fish and brews is just the hard bread and fish.
It's not that salty.
No.
No.
Unless I mean, you know, most Newfoundlanders put salt on salt beef, so it could be really salty. Depends who makes it, but what I've had, like Bidgood's. There you go. Shout out to Bidgood's in the Ghouls. They actually have good fish and brews.
Oh, do they?
Yeah.
And I could go down to Velma's and get it, too, if I want.
Velma's, yeah. Velma's is a bit overpriced.
Oh,
but,
is it?
But if you want to sponsor me, you can. No, I actually walked in Velma's one time and walked out.
Oh, because of the...
Yeah, I was like, oh, this must be a reasonably priced... I'm not cheap, but I was like, this must be reasonably priced if it's selling fish and chips. And I walked in, I was like, I can see a menu. Yeah, see you later. That's how that went down. I was like, no, man. Mm. No. Saint Bianca's. Like, have you ever been to Bianca's?
I have, yep.
Yeah. Whatever. You're not an average person. Hey, okay, I can't talk.
What does that mean?
I can't talk those problems. Yeah. That's probably the pinnacle of pricey food, Bianca's. Or duck on water, is that what it's called? Duck on water?
Duck on water, I haven't been there, I don't think. Duck on water?
Blue on water?
Blue on water.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, blue on water.
Duck on water. Have you been there?
I have been
See,
there.
You can't even, no. You're like that, my budget's McDonald's. Ish,
oh,
like the $1.39 menu. I think the priciest place I've ever been to is what's that Indian place? India Gate.
Oh, I love India Gate's really, really good.
Yeah,
a lot of people come here from away, like they come here for the show from away, and they say it's the best Indian food they've ever had.
It is good. I actually, first time I had it, I shouldn't be covering my mouth because I won't be able to hear me. First time I had it was, I think a year, 2 years ago, probably. And I like spicy food. So I ordered something, and it said in the menu, you know, spicy. And then a waitress came over, and she was horrible at telling me how spicy it was. Like, how spicy is this? And she's like, you know, it's spicy. I was like, I can read that. But how spicy is it? Well, you know, the chef puts his spices in there. That's what she said. She's like, yeah, the chef puts spices and stuff.
And how is it spicy?
Oh, it burned a... let me say this for Lee Newfoundlander. Burned a mout right off you.
Oh, did it?
Oh, my God. I've never tasted something so spicy in my life.
Did you have a little yogurt drink or something to...
No, I had water.
Water? You're supposed to have, like,
milk.
A yogurt.
Or milk, yeah.
Milk, yeah.
But no, she bought... She knew. She knew because she set me up for us. Like, oh, yeah, no, it's you know, the chef, the spices. I was like, okay. And then before she brought the food out, she brought over a big jug of water. And I was like, this is going down. This is not going to be that. This is going to be. And it's really, really spicy. Like, I'm talking really burn the mouth.
Hot as it gets.
Just gone, yeah. Yeah. But I ate it.
And you ate it? Whole thing?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hot stuff's supposed to be good for you.
Took the bullet. You sweat when you eat it. It's weird.
Yeah.
I was sweating eating it, and my nose is running. Like that's how I get flu symptoms when I eat spicy food.
I like that feeling.
That's why it's weird.
No, it's just a good. I mean, if it's good spicy food, I like that.
Oh yeah. If it's moderately all right to eat. Like I went home and I went back to my house later, and I had a bit. I bring it home because I never finished it because I couldn't have would have died. And my mom hates it. She hates spicy food. Like, she can't... Like, she finds, like, the smallest... I can't even think of anything right now. But, like, the smallest not spicy thing... Like, buffalo wings. Fantastic. Buffalo wings are great. I love them.
Yeah.
My mom, like, way too hot. Yeah, too much. And so I brought this home. And I was like, hey, come here, Mom. She came over. I was like, get a piece of bread. She got a piece of bread. I was like, dip it in there. Have a bit of that. She's like, what's that? I'm like, oh, no.
Oh, you didn't. You set her up?
The waitress set me up. It's a circle of life.
But then you did it to your mom?
Man. It's like, Mom, just dip your bread in there. She dipped it in and she ate it and flipped out, spit in the garbage. And
Oh, your poor mom.
That's the end of that. It was funny. She never died. Should have known it was coming. So I guess it leads to the next question. What's your favorite place to go? Not to, okay, let's go to eat and then just to go in general.
To go in St. John's? In St. John's.
Sure, yeah.
I really like, Get Stuffed a lot.
I haven't been there.
I really like that. I really like Get Stuffed. I love the people who work there, and I love the atmosphere, and the food is great. And you can go and have a really laid back night, or you can get a little dressed up if you feel like it. And I like it there a lot.
Okay, so that's to eat. What about just to go for the sake of, like, not to eat, but just, like, a place to, like, case beer or something, like, a place to go? Yeah.
I really like Middle Cove and Logie Bay. Like, if I'm going to go for, like, a walk.
Logie Bay? Isn't that by the studios? Keep it home?
Not anymore, no. We used to have a studio out there.
That's where Maggie is. On Logie
Maggie,
Bay.
Yeah. But we're the studio, everything's in the Torbay studio now.
Oh, why Logie Bay? Like, what? It's just like the road?
I like Middle Cove, and then you can sort of walk along if you want, and I just like that.
Topsail Beach?
Oh, I like Topsail Beach a lot, too, yeah. Manuals,
yeah.
Yeah.
Holyrood,
yeah.
You used to go swimming in Holyrood when I was a kid.
Me, too. That pool there?
Like, that's specific.
The only?
That pool? That water place? Where water
the
is
water hole?
Where water is held?
I think the only outdoor pool in Holyrood.
Well, it's not like a pool.
But there's a pool. Like an outdoor pool. I don't know if it's still there anymore.
Like a pool? Like an ocarina pool?
Not an ocarina pool, but like a outdoor...
There's a dippy hole thing.
Like a dipping hole.
That's a horrible way to explain it. It's like, you go off the road and there's a house to your right and there's like a little beach. And then there's a... swimming thing that like it's a little thing and then
it's wood. Wow, it's my... that's got wood all along.
Yeah.
That one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's cool. I used to go there. Yeah.
Well, then took my thunder away from that story. I went there first, man. I discovered that place. Yeah, we have one thing in common. We swam in the same swimming hole
in Holyrood.
God, Holyrood. Have you yourself been starstruck?
Yes.
Because I know you must have met a lot of known, like Russell Crowe and Paul Gross. And
yeah, I'm star. Anytime I meet anybody like that, I'm kind of most starstruck by
me.
I know. By you.
No, I can tell you. Yeah, I knew. See little stars in people's.
I thought I was hiding it so well.
Yeah, no, not really. Annie Jones saying when he came in, he was like, "You can't even speak to me." I'm like, "It's okay. Yeah, I'm just like you."
To get him going.
I was like, "I'm just like you, except God made me
just
better."
Just an ordinary guy. Yeah. I'm most starstruck by people from like celebrities from Newfoundland. So
really,
yeah, like Gordon Pinsent.
I'm the opposite. I'm like. Like, it's like when I first met you just now, I was like, wow, it's just cool. But I don't know, with Newfoundland, I it's different, I guess, because I guess they're from here. I'm more like, oh, it's me. They're like me.
But they're part of my childhood. I don't know. I'm more connected to them, and they're part of my, like, so it's somebody I've sort of grown up watching and somebody who's really close to home, and then I get really, really excited. But I get excited in a, who did I get? Definitely Russell Crowe. I totally was starstruck. I met Ralph Fiennes once. I was really starstruck.
What about Annie? Did you meet Annie Jones?
Yeah, I love must have. Andy. That's we did it. Yeah, father. Martha's dead, and I love Andy. And we had I just had a moment. We did a jury or something. We were, we had to get together with Greg Malone, Andy Jones, Linda Boyd, Mark O'Brien, and myself, and we all had to get together. For a jury for an award or something like that, and I was like sitting in Linda's living room, and I thought, "Holy bleep! I'm here. I'm here with Greg Malone, Andy Jones, Linda, Mark, and we sat together. We went through the whole process, and we had lunch together. That was a starstruck moment for me. I thought to be thinking that I'd be sitting there with them.
Yeah, well, to be able to take yourself all the moment and go, wow, look who's around me right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
I actually worked at Mark last summer.
Oh, did you?
Worked. Yeah, he did a thing for Mun and the Mun reunion.
Oh, cool.
And he hosted it. And I did a... They did like a character
thing.
Oh,
at the Mile One?
Yeah.
I was there for that. That was a great night.
Yeah, well, I wasn't there, no. But we did... they had like three characters, one from the 70s, 80s, and 90s. And so I played the guy from the 90s.
Oh, nice.
And yeah, he's a nice guy.
He is a great guy.
I've actually met him
a
couple times before. And I was like, "Mark, do you know who I am?" He's like, "No." He just looked at me. I'm like, "We've met like four times." Yeah, like I was like, "Yeah, no, it's okay.
Oh.
It's all right." And I went home and wept, crunching, holding my picture of Ellen Harko, going, "Why?" No, actually, I met Mark a couple times.
Yeah, he's nice a guy. Doll. He's a real sweetheart.
I've met Alan, I guess, kind of. Like, I got his autograph a couple of years ago.
Oh, cool.
That was weird. He's a small man. He's smaller than what he looks on television. I'm like, he must be tall. No.
We all get that. Everyone thinks a camera does something. The camera sort of does something.
No, Alan's nice.
He's wonderful.
I had like two sentences with him. And then I've seen Linda once at Tim Hortons.
Oh, yeah?
And I didn't meet her. I was seeing her there. Yeah. And
she's awesome. Martha?
Oh yeah, I met Martha.
Yeah.
Steve O'Connell.
Oh yeah.
He actually taught me English.
Oh my god, yeah. He's the best. Great. I love that. I get to be his partner. It's the best thing.
Yeah, he's really nice, yeah. I like Steve.
He's great. He's a great guy to have on set too.
Hood. what's your favorite thing to do? Besides acting, like hobby, knit.
I love to knit.
Really?
No.
I love knitting.
No. Friday. Not that there's anything wrong with knitting, but I wouldn't. I don't think I don't know if I'd be good at it or if I'd be able to sit down for that.
I had the patience. I wouldn't have the patience to knit.
No, like you gotta I don't know.
Do it from scratch.
It'd probably be good for me.
No, probably good.
To build my patience.
No,
but
I don't have time for that.
Favorite thing to do, I like spending time with my friends as much as I can. Like, it's just like hanging out with my friends, and I like traveling a lot. I really like traveling a lot. And reading. I like traveling a lot whenever I can.
What's the coolest place you've been to?
Coolest place.
Or your favorite place?
My favorite place that I've been to is Paris.
Paris? I'm going to Paris in May.
Are you?
Yeah.
Oh. Bring me something back.
Here's a bottle of air from Paris.
Some Parisian air. That's my favorite. Oh, anywhere in France.
Maybe I'll get a life-size cutout of you. I'll take a picture of me and you, but I flip
just out. Like, hey. Emily style, like the gnome.
Yeah, yeah.
You put
just your. She was there. Can't you see? She's two-dimensional now.
Postcards.
She's lost a lot of weight. You can't see her when she turns on sideways. Why is she brown on the back? That's weird. Where did you go, Paris? Just Paris or France itself?
I've been to Paris, and then I've been to Burgundy. Went to a little tiny place called Beaune, B-E-A-U-N-E. It's like a little tiny wine village. But I like Paris. I went there and did it. So going there and renting an apartment is the way to do it. I went there with my mom, and we rented an apartment above the bakery that had won the first prize for the best croissant in Paris. First prize.
That's like the main reason why I want to go. I am a huge dessert fan.
Lose your mind. Have you never been?
To Paris?
Yeah. Have you never been? No,
I haven't been to Bianca's, Krystin. Obviously, I haven't been to Paris.
Oh, you're going to have the best time ever. And if you're a dessert guy, you're going to lose it.
Yeah, well, I eat supper just to get dessert. Yeah. That's why I roll.
Just wait. Just wait.
That's
you'll have patisseries coming out of your ears.
You probably want to say something else there, didn't you? You said ears. That's such a 50s thing to say in the radio. Ah, your ears. Sit on it. Well, you know, we're going to northern France and southern France.
Oh, my goodness. You're going, like, to
we're doing 2 weeks.
Nice? Are you going to Nice and, like, down?
I don't know the specific towns, but we're doing a week in southern and a week in northern. So we're seeing, like, on a countryside. And then we're staying in Paris a couple of days.
Oh, my God.
And, yeah.
You got to tell me all about it because I've never been to the south. I want to go to the south of France.
That'd be weird if they had, like, southern accents like Americans. You want to do it? Oh. No, we're going to Euro Disney.
Oh, and, cool.
Park Asterix.
Oh, cool.
Were you there? You should have been there. Never See, that's, been. Again, never that's been. One of those places. I love parks.
Like oh, that,
like roller coasters.
I can't do anything motion. Roller coasters, swings, cars.
Swings. Cars.
Nothing.
Cars.
How'd cars.
You, a car? Like, how'd you get here?
What if you're, I'm? I mean, if I'm driving long distance in the back seat of a car, I can't do anything. Sort of.
Have you tried? Have you like give it a chance to get on a roller coaster? You never know. Maybe
I did. I tried. I did try. I got sick once, and then why would I do that again?
Just well, maybe it's something so you sick. Ate.
No, it was definitely the roller coaster.
The first time I got on a roller coaster, I was in, I think, grade 6. And my stories are old. My stories are older than yours. Grade 6, that's a while. And I went with my family to Florida. And we went to SeaWorld as the first theme park we went to. And they have the Kraken roller coaster.
Oh, my God.
Which is the one that flips upside down and does all that jumble jumble. Anyway, so me and my sister... And my mother, because my dad, he's like you. He can't handle that kind of stuff. But he hasn't even tried it. At least you've tried it. But he's like, no, can't do heights. I'm like, okay. And so me and my mom, my sister went up. Again, I hadn't been on anything like that in my life at this point. And I was like, I don't know, how old are you, grade 6? 12?
12, yep.
I don't know, see, and I failed math.
No, I just remember being 12. In grade 6. It's no math.
No.
No.
Mine was. Yeah, so we went up and we're about to get, we're like, the there's like 3-4 people ahead of us. Like, we're the next batch to get on. And, you know, I was getting like chest pains. Like, I was nervous. Like, I was like, oh, God, I don't know this. And so I guess my mother and sister seen that. And they're like, yeah, no, we're not going to get on it now. Like, my sister, like, started crying. And my mom was like, no, I can't do it now. Like, we were next. She's like, no, I can't. They abandoned
and you
me. No, I didn't bail. They bailed on me, and I went on by myself.
Yeah. Oh my God, you're braver than me.
But no, it worked out. There was a father, and he had a good looking daughter. She was next to me.
Oh well, then it worked out.
She put on my seatbelt.
Well, that's nice.
I never heard from her after.
Oh.
I thought the date went well.
Heartbreak on the roller coaster.
It was all too many. Yeah. Should have been called a heartbreak. And said the Kraken. That was a horrible joke. But yeah, no, that's how that went down. And I felt like I needed it because my mother made me take off my glasses. She's like, yeah, no, take them off. They might fly off.
Yeah, they would. They would,
but
totally
they didn't.
Fly.
No, they didn't. That was the one time I took them off. And then we went to Florida. And then we did like the other theme parks. And I didn't. And then we went back to Florida a second time. And I didn't take them off once. They don't fly. They don't fly off. I feel like a moron. I'm like, here you go.
Inertia or something keeps them on. Gravity. And
I'm not science.
You're
just throwing out words. Inertia, Newton's law.
I'm just a parrot.
No, but I guess, well, they hook on, you know, to like the back, like sunglasses. They hook on to the back of your ears.
Yeah.
So unless you're getting like shook or, you know, flicked around. But I feel like a moron. I got off my glasses. Yep. That's my story about Florida. Florida's atrocious. It's so hot. Like, did you go to Florida? Have you been to Florida?
I went once when we were, like, 14 or something.
Did you like it?
I don't really remember much about it.
It's too hot.
Yeah, it was really hot.
I'm not one for heat. Mm-hmm. Like, are you here the whole year in St. John's?
No, I normally go back to Toronto.
In summer?
For the winter time. From January to July. So, but then this year I've been kind of back and forth and kind of here for the winter a little bit, but I go back and forth.
Yeah, see, heat, I can't do it. Like last summer here, you were here last summer, I assume.
Yeah.
Too hot. It was way too hot.
Oh, beautiful.
No,
it was
gorgeous. Couldn't do it. I was nauseous every day. I just couldn't. I can't handle heat.
I used to be that way, and now I can. Now I like it, and I need some heat and some sun.
Florida was bad for me. Okay. You have to come up with something for this question.
Oh.
Okay. Ready?
Okay.
You ready? Funniest joke. Go. Uh-oh.
You're talking to the... Oh.
Nothing over here. There's no jokes over here.
Funniest joke?
Funniest joke. Yep.
I don't know any jokes.
I do a segment on this. I do bad jokes of the week, which I just read out bad jokes every week. I don't know why I do it. It's not popular, but it makes me laugh to read bad. They're not my jokes. I search them up, and you know, they're all bad, obviously, but they make me laugh. Anyway, spotlight's on you, miss. So
I don't have any. I'm really terrible at improv. I can't think of any.
You don't know one joke?
I don't know one
joke.
Not
one joke. Not even like
I don't know one joke.
Like the rabbi and priest walking to a bar. Like, you don't know one. Okay, I'll give you a bad one, and maybe it'll spark something. Okay, here's a bad one that I've read before.
Okay.
What kind of underwear do clouds wear?
What?
Thunderwear.
Thunderwear. That's really cute.
Oh, my God. What? No, it's horrible.
That's cute.
It's not a pet bunny. It's not cute.
Thunderwear.
Okay, maybe you can spark something off of that.
Oh, this is so discouraging. You really can't come up with anything.
Okay, I'll give you another bad one. I'll just start this one just now.
Okay.
So there's a ham, not a pig, a ham.
Yeah.
And this ham was an actor, okay?
Okay.
And so the ham was on stage, and he was acting, and the director called out, "Hey, you gotta ham it up." Horrible. You don't even get it, see? That's the point. You need to say something.
No, that was a bad one, yeah.
Yeah,
that see, was a bad
that hurts
one.
My confidence.
Oh, I'm sorry,
no,
but you threw
that's
it
horrible.
Out there.
No, it's bad. I know it's bad.
Do you want a tissue?
I'm fine. I got my Alan Hocko picture at home.
I don't have one. I
not
still
one.
Don't, I still don't what? Have one.
Oh my.
Oh.
Now, a knock knock joke. Really?
Really? I can't think of it. There's just so much pressure.
See, this is what grows. This is what happens when you grow up in Mount Pearl. You're deprived.
No, no, no. This has nothing to do with... No, no, no.
No, don't pick up for the pearl.
Hey, that's my homeland.
Your homeland, not a country. That's my place of residence. I live in the vicinity of the place. Do you still live in Mountboro?
My birthplace. No.
No, see? St. John's?
Not even really. I don't keep a place. I travel around a lot, so I don't keep a place.
Just carry a box around?
Carry a box. I have a blanket and a stick.
A stick? You tent it up.
Yeah.
Lie down, yeah.
Yeah.
So you have a knock-knock joke. Not even like the classic, like knock-knock.
Who's there?
Boo.
Boo who?
Why are you crying? See, like not even like a bad one like that. This is making me look bad. All my bad jokes. People are never going to come see my act now. No, he's all about horrible. God. These jokes are bad. It's your time to shine.
My time to shine still?
Maybe,
I've left the station. I don't have anything Hako, here for you. Maybe, I really don't.
Maybe if Hako hears your good joke, he'll give you another part.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Is everything riding on this?
Everything is riding on this. If you don't do this, if you don't say any kind of joke, your home box will blow away.
My home box?
The box you live in for a home. It'll just blow. I'll tear it up.
You'll tear
so
up?
So all it'll have is a blanket and a stick.
The littlest hobo. I really am terrible.
What?
I really am challenged. Oh,
smack my face off the mic.
I'm really totally challenged. I cannot come up with.
Story? Funny story, bad story, some kind of story.
I just get nervous. I don't know. I don't have.
Clamming up.
I'm clamming right up.
That's a weird expression. The clams. Clams notorious for being nervous. What does that even mean? You're clamming up.
Well, they're pretty. They're pretty tight lipped. They clam up.
They have shells. They have lips. Clams have tight lips. So they don't often.
God.
That could actually be taken in the wrong context.
Oh, God.
Wow. Now, welcome to the X-rated show.
No. It's family.
It's family, yeah. Obviously, you haven't heard my show before. Shells, they have shells.
They definitely do.
Yep. Some have lips. I don't know. I haven't met them all.
I don't know what kind of.
You know what I'm always. You know what I'm fascinated about? Are jellyfish.
I haven't seen one in a long time.
I don't know how they live. How do they live? They don't have a heart. They don't have a brain.
They float.
That's the smartest thing you've said so far.
Excuse me?
They float. They float. But they don't have, you know what I mean? Like, they don't have a heart. They don't have any kind of organ. How do they?
I don't know anything about jellyfish.
I don't know. I'm fascinated about how they live. That sounds really weird. Do you have any advice for aspiring actors? Don't take my
advice
job.
No, my God, no. I think that whatever's for you won't ever go by you. So there's no sort of like, the jobs that you're meant to get are like, I think that. There's room for everybody. Anyway, just to sort of, but advice would be to surround yourself with people who are sincere about the work, and to always find a way to be working and learning and seeing as much as you can, ask questions always, and just try and see the best films, the best television, the best plays, and just trust that, and don't give up too soon. That's the thing. Like, you got to give it a bit. It's the same with any business plan, I think. That's what I was told, is that you got to give it, I mean, unless you're given some sort of clear sign that you're meant to be doing something else, that to give it a good five, I said to myself, a good 5 years. And then if after 5 years, I'd sort of really start reevaluating.
So what year did you accomplish your goal in that 5 years?
Where was I at that 5 year mark?
Yeah, like now you obviously have a job in Doyle.
Yeah.
So like, was that during your 5 year?
Well, plan? I graduated. I graduated in 2005, and then Doyle came up in 2009.
Oh.
So, but there were lots of times when, you know, and I'm sure, I mean, there's all, I'm sure I'll be back there in my mind again, but like wondering, is this what I should be doing? Am I doing the right thing? And always questioning. That's not a bad thing either, you know? But that's...
What about advice to handle negative criticism? Or people that say, oh, you can't do it, you know?
I think being exposed to that kind of thing is healthy, and it sort of teaches you how to sort of be resilient, and it might not be comfortable at the time, but any way that you can sort of take whatever's useful about it and then move on. I mean, that's, but it's not necessarily a bad thing, and it's unavoidable. Like, everybody goes through that in any line of work, you know, in any sort of, if you're a performer, if you're a...
Have you had bad feedback on Doyle, about Doyle?
I'm not aware of it. I don't sort of seek it out, you know. Like, why not? I don't go trying to find terrible things being written about, you know. But or said so. But I have had bad. I've had not the greatest reviews in plays and things like that. And I've had, and obviously, most of the time in the audition process, you're rejected for.
Oh, I know, yeah.
A number of reasons.
I've had auditions for Doyle. I know what that's like.
Yeah, so that's my experience.
What kind of role do you enjoy playing most? Like, I know you really enjoyed playing the aspect that Leslie went through.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what kind of role are you drawn to? Like, a dramatic role, a comedic role, a...
I like really complex characters that are, it doesn't feel the best. It might not be the most comfortable process, and I might not feel confident at all, but whatever sort of outside of myself, like something that's, I like transforming, or I like being asked to transform. And I like being a part of projects that are just really well written. So, because that makes all the difference in the world. That's what you kind of,
that was a very subtle, good job to Alan there. I like jobs that are good written, Alan.
But it's true though. I mean, it really is. I mean, that's the greatest gift, is to have a script that's, or to be given a character that's well developed and to be given really good dialogue and good sort of conflict. That's what it's all about. Otherwise, it's...
Yeah, I really like the whole Leslie Skeet thing.
That was so much fun. That was so much fun.
Would you rather play that kind of role than the original, the way Leslie is actually, like, her original character? Did you have more fun playing the Skeet, I guess?
I had fun. I have fun playing both, because... Leslie in her real world, sort of, I didn't feel like, I wasn't sure if I could, if, you know, I had to really sort of try and find that strength that she has, because that's not something that I could sort of find naturally. Like, I had to find out how strong, like a cop is strong, and that was really tricky, and that really pushed me. And then to take it even further in that direction and find that other kind of like grit and strength, like, that was really challenging.
So for research, did you go out and like sell drugs?
No. No, I didn't do
that. No, but I did it on the internet.
But I did speak with the RNC have been so helpful, and I did speak to cops about like what that's like, and try to get an idea what that's like, and also learning about addiction and Oxy and that whole world and everything. It was really eye-opening and terrifying, actually.
I find it hilarious how you guys shot all that in Buckmaster. Given, yeah. like, given, given the reputation locally.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, ah, locals get that. Okay, off the acting thing. Okay, here we go. Best or worst pickup line? Boom.
The worst pickup line?
Let's go with,
Ruffles chips. You can't just have one. Somebody said that to me once.
Really?
Yeah.
Someone said that to you?
I'm like a ruffle chip or something.
You're a ruffle chip?
No, I'm not a ruffle chip. I'm not Ruffles. I'm a... Lays? The guy was... Lays. That's what it is. He said, I'm like a bag of Lays. You can't just have one. 100% serious.
Was that... Oh, God. Was that recent?
No, that was a very long time ago.
Before Doyle?
Yeah.
You have some during Doyle now, because people know who you were. You've had to have like a guy that's come up and...
They go like this.
Really?
To get handcuffed.
Oh, yeah. My God. Oh, God. I'm going to just apologize.
For Deuce. Or you can arrest me anytime.
Yeah. Yeah.
That one's a favorite.
See, I don't get why. I don't understand why. I don't get how guys, like, you know, I mean, I'm saying it like I'm not one, but I mean, I'm not that species of dude, I guess, where it's just like, hey, this one's going to work. Did you fall from heaven? Because you're an angel. Like that. Like, what's in your mind going? She's going to like that. She's going to like that one. Yeah, she's going to. That's a great pickup line. Like, you know, they must think that it's going to work. How? What goes in your mind is going to, you know, that's a good pickup line. It's horrible.
You know, it takes, if people put themselves out there, you know, that not everybody.
No, now you put up on a pedestal. They're horrible people. You can't. Well, you know, you got to give it to them. They have guts.
They got guts. They come up to you. You know, I don't know. I mean.
What about best one? Have you had the guys?
Best one.
You've had has one dude at least say something nice. Well, not nice, but you know, good, actual good one.
An actual good one. The guy, I don't know. They just sort of don't say it. They just sort of they would like, I don't know. Not they wouldn't be a line. They would just be generally. Charming. I don't know. I mean,
has a bad one. Have you ever contemplated maybe going on a date with a guy, even though he said a bad pickup line with you? Like, have you ever been like, oh, that's actually kind of creative?
If he was being, I don't know, if he was being funny,
and that's it was chancy. Actually, yeah, funny. That's gambling to go up to a girl you don't know and say a bad one purposely, and go, no, I was joking. That's really risky.
If sometimes people are funny and charming. I don't know why. I'd have to be in the situation.
I actually asked Eddie Pasquale the same question about pickup lines. And I forget what he told me now. Ah, he had a girlfriend, so he didn't want to tell me any.
Oh.
I was like, man, come on. Have you ever used one?
Have I ever used one? No, I can't say I have.
Yeah, it seems like a lying face. No.
You can't see it on the radio.
Yeah, and I actually heard that in the mic.
Oh.
Okay. That's actually everything I have to ask you.
Oh, cool.
That was, yeah. Well, that pickup line one kind of deflated me. I was expecting a good pickup line. The one that I don't know, that cop one is not that's too easy. It's not creative.
What cop one?
That wrist, put your hands out, arrest me one.
It's a good solid one. That's why they use it. That's what
it's a solid one.
It's a good go-to. It's a good go-to. It's
lazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are better ones. But I haven't heard them.
This interview is ending on a depressing note. No, it's not.
No.
Puppies and bunnies and stuff and happy things. You want to give a synopsis of tonight's episode?
tonight's episode, you'll have to check in and tune in and find out.
Do you not know what back. One it is?
Well, I know that that Jake's former flame is back in the picture tonight. And so there's interesting.
Yeah, I kind of wonder what happened to her. She's kind of disappeared from the story.
Yeah. She's back tonight, so we'll see what happens. Lots of complications.
So in the show now, is Jake and Leslie, are they a thing?
They are a thing. They are a thing.
And Alan's going to keep it that way, isn't he? well, that's great. That airs 9:30?
9:30 tonight.
And then as well as like 2-3 episodes left.
Yep.
So it's going to be a break now, or are they all going to air in the next weeks?
I think it's back to back. Yeah.
And you'll hear about season 5. So when will the public know if there's season 5?
I guess they'll know the same time we'll know, which will be, I'm not sure when. I think it will be in the next little while, like the next week or a couple weeks.
I'm going on a limb and saying it's going to be season 5. Now, if I'm correct.
I hope so. From your lips to knock on
to the
wood.
Clam's lips. If I'm correct, that's weird. If I'm correct, then I have to have a guest spot on the show. There we go. A deal has been made on the radio. I'll take my talking
it's
clam.
On the air. You take your, it's on the air. It's
out there now.
It's out there in the universe.
Yeah. Because I've had like 10 auditions already.
I'll send out good thoughts.
Yeah. He has a talking clam. How can you pass him up? But no, it's been great talking to you.
It's been really great talking to you.
And yeah, you're welcome back whenever.
Thanks.
You can come back and co-host.
That would be fun.
You and me and my talking clam.
That would be pretty funny.
But yeah, check out Republic of Doyle tonight at 9:30 if you're in Newfoundland. If you're listening online, then it's at 8, right? Hour and a half difference?
An hour and a half difference? It's on 9 o'clock on the mainland.
9 o'clock. Okay, 9, yeah. 9 mainland, 9:30 Newfoundland. Well, thank you, Krystin.
Thanks so much for having me.
You can follow her on Twitter at talking clam. And... And thanks guys for joining us, and I'll see you again next week. Have a safe one.